As always, good morning, Bob and the band. Yes. Isn't that a great way to be greeted and to wake up on Sunday morning to Bob and the band? We appreciate you guys very much, very much. So I'm Anne, and I'm excited to welcome all of you here today. I'm going to encourage you and maybe even get down on my knees and beg you. Bring a friend. Look at all the space we have available. And we know that people are watching from home, and we know that you know, we're popular in the neighborhood, but bring a friend. What would happen if we did bring a friend Sunday? Wouldn't that be fun? Well, hey, good. I'm gonna talk to Princess Debbie and ask her if we can do that sometime soon. Yes. Okay, good. So if you happen to be with us for the first time, we want to welcome you to Unity of Dallas, and make sure if you haven't filled out a guest card that you do that either at the next desk or at the reception desk. Let me remind you that we do not follow you home. We do not bombard you with mail and phone calls and emails. You get one email from me, and then we hope you're on board. So we're excited that you're here. And I also want to remind you, all of us, to stop at the Book Nook, because we're having a sale. Some of it's 50% off. This is one of my favorite things. It's a love rock. And one of the reasons I love it so much is that my sister in Carmel, California, makes these for us. She doesn't make the rock. God made the rock. She makes the, yeah. So, but it's, we put them in our plants. We put them in little gift baskets when we, and they're just beautiful and darling, and they've been prayed over. So books on sale, love rocks on sale, jewelry on sale, lots of wonderful things in the Book Nook. So be sure you visit there. So, I think I have done what I need to do until right now when we do the opening statement, and I'm going to ask you to take a breath and say it like you mean it. There is only one presence and one power active in my life and in the universe: God the Good, Omnipotent. So some quick announcements before we get started. Coffee and conversation in Fellowship Hall, 12 to 1, as always. Also snacks. So if you're wanting to stay for Alan's class at 1 o'clock or for some other meeting or whatever, make sure that you grab a snack so that you can make it through. Alan's class today is going to be really exciting. I'm so excited because I get to talk. Does that surprise anybody? I promise not to go on and on, but it's going to, I've reviewed it and looked at what Alan's cooking. It's going to be very exciting, okay? It's an interactive workshop from 1 to 3. I love the title, Beyond Improbable, the Extraordinary True Stories that Many of Us Have to Share, and it will be a small love offering, whatever you choose. Be sure you check the e-news for the event calendar. There are 5 events next Saturday. So it's Divine Sisters, Voices of Unity Choir kickoff, near and dear to Philip's heart. If you want to sing, please drop. You can stop by the next desk where you can sign up. And most of you are familiar. Some of you are new. The next desk right outside the door is where you can sign up to volunteer for something or to attend a class or to pick up a little flyer with what's coming up next week or so. So be sure that you come by. I'll be out there as soon as church is over with a couple of friends. So 5 events. Divine Sisters. If you don't know what that is a gathering of the women in the church, and everybody brings a potluck and they have a speaker, and that's on Saturday morning. I think it starts what time? 10:30, loud and clear. Thank you. All right. New drum circle. Who can tell us a little bit more about that? Philip, do you know anything about the drum circle? All right, so if you want to learn to play the drums or join in Fellowship Hall, and that's next Saturday, do you know what time?
In the evening.
Good, okay. love offering also. And last, we are starting two community outreach projects, the Holistic Festival and Feed the Children. So if you want to know more about those, also stop by the next desk. And I see Michael wandering our way. Come on up, Michael. You obviously have something you want to share.
Just a quick reminder that over the last couple of Sundays, we have distributed a survey. I believe we gave over 100 surveys, and we only got 49. So we need your help. The Unity Board of Directors are needing your assistance in identifying what kind of programs we need to keep on moving with and which ones we need to, you know, bring on board. So if you need a survey, please let Aaron know. He's distributed them right now. And you can just drop them off at the next desk or give them to me. I'll be out there. You don't have to be a member of Unity of Dallas, or an official member, okay? So you can also fill out the survey. The other one is about the Ministerial Call Committee. Don't forget that we are also asking for people to participate in the search for our next senior minister. So if you want to be part of that committee, please fill out an application. Aaron also has copies of those. And lastly, the raffle, okay? There's a condominium in Orlando, Florida for a 7-day stay that you can be the winner of. Today, the drawing is going to take place in the fellowship hall during our coffee and conversation. Tickets are still available. They're $10 a piece or 6 for $50. So that's it.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Give Michael a hand. Thank you. And now it's time for us to say hello to each other. So please take a second. You don't have to stand, but you can stand, and you can hug or shake hands or whatever you want to do. But greet each other warmly, please.
Nailed it.
With your guidance.
You're
thank
a pro.
You,
you got
thank
this.
Thank you. Get this out of the way. Let's do a little greeting with me. Thank you, darling girl.
Okay, Unity of Dallas, come back to your seats, and as you're saying your final hugs and handshakes, I want you to join together in song with something that's true. You are in the right place. We're all going to sing together. I'm in the right place. Here we go. I'm in the right place at the right time. I am just where I'm supposed to be. I'm in the right place at the right time. I am just where I'm supposed to be. I'm in the right place at the right time. I am just where I'm supposed to be. I'm in the right place at the right time. I am just where I'm supposed to be. Oh, my soul is welcome here. Oh, my soul is welcome here. I am getting the message loud and clear. My soul is welcome here. Oh, my soul is welcome here. Oh, my soul is welcome here. I am getting the message loud and clear. My soul is welcome here. There you go. Let's get some clapping going on. I'm in the right place.
I'm in the right place at the right time. I am just what I'm supposed to be. I'm in the right place at the right time. I am just what I'm supposed to be. I'm in the right place at the right time. I am just what I'm supposed to be. I'm in the right place at the right time. I am just just what I'm supposed to be. Oh, my soul is welcome here. Oh, my soul is welcome here. I am getting the message loud and clear. My soul is welcome here. Oh, my soul is welcome here. Oh, my soul is welcome here. I am getting the message loud and clear. My soul is welcome
here. I am getting the message loud and clear. My soul is welcome here. Woo! Yeah, Spirit Fingers, yeah! Woo! All right. Good morning, Unity.
I love it.
And good morning to you. Welcome, welcome.
Well, obviously, our souls are welcome here. I love it. Hello, everyone. I'm Louise Ross. I am honored to be your chaplain for today. Know anyone wearing these beautiful stoles is available for you for prayer one-on-one. Come see us. We're scattered around, and we're also by the chapel. I'm going to remind you we have prayer chests. We're going to talk about prayer in about 13 seconds. But feel free to drop a request in where we pray over them for the week and send them to Unity for another month of prayer. Shall we say together our daily word? Prosperity. I live an abundant life. I'm going to ask you to breathe deeply, freeing your mind, opening your heart, and allowing your soul to focus on the idea of abundance. Every thought is an intention. Every intention is a prayer. Each thought that we hold in mind creates a chemical foundation which goes out into the universe as energy. We are spiritual beings, and that is the source of our abundance. I'm going to ask you now to quietly focus on your areas of abundance. Health. Raise the vibration of high, pure health. Prosperity. Allow that thought to rise and become more and multiply, so you can receive. Connection and well-being. Allow that thought to elevate and up-level to a higher plane. Knowing we are spiritual beings in this human experience. And for that, I am grateful. And so it is. Amen.
Let's continue. You're invited to stay seated, but I encourage you to sing with us, Sanctuary. If you don't know this song already, you'll get to know it pretty quick. Join in as you can. Lord, prepare me.
Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true, with thanksgiving I'll be a living sanctuary for you. It is you, Lord, who came to help the heart and soul. Strength with
Our guest artist for this morning.
Go out and tell our story, let it echo far and wide. Make them hear you, make them hear you. How justice was our battle, and how justice was denied. Make them hear you, make them hear you. And say to those who blame us for the way we chose to fight, that sometimes there are battles which are more than black or white. And I could not put down my sword when justice was my right. Make them hear you. Make them hear you. Go out and tell the story to your daughters and your sons. Make them hear you. Make them hear you. And tell them in our struggle, we were not the only ones. Make them hear you. Make them hear you. Your sword can be a sermon or the power of the pen. Teach every child to raise his voice, and then, my brothers, then will justice be demanded by 10 million righteous men? Make them hear you. When they hear you, I'll be near you again.
How old are you now?
I'm 18.
And Aunt Debbie, how long has he been singing for us? He's been, in case you didn't
Neither
hear,
could you.
He's been singing since he was two and they couldn't get him to shut up. So here he is. Honey, you are a blessing and thank you so much. It is my honor today to introduce our guest speaker, someone very familiar with the majority of you, Lesa Walker. We're excited that she's delivering us a good talk today. She enjoys living out her purpose of healing by combining her previous life in integrative medicine with the spiritual teaching she has explored for most of her adult life. She is an LUT, licensed unity teacher. She holds a master's degree in religion. But the life-changing teachings have come through less standardized learning processes, as life does give us lessons. Her goal as a teacher is to see our lives transformed. Welcome, Lesa Walker.
It feels kind of funny to be introduced as a guest speaker in my own home, with my own family. And I am just so grateful to you guys for being here. I would just have a request for you that maybe you trickle in a little faster, because it's really ego triggering when nobody's here at the beginning of the service. Anyways, I do want to shout out a couple of people. Philip, you're one of them. Philip just brings such a, it's such a great music experience we're having, right? And I'm a musician. I used to sing in my younger years. I could have sang to this full room and never been nervous. But when I'm going to speak, the nerves just go blah, 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 blah. And he picks just the right songs to get me calmed down. He's not doing it for me, but it works for me every time to just get me calmed down. There's another person I decided I want to call out today, Ron Alvey. How many of y'all know Coach Ron? Coach Ron is one, he didn't know I was going to do this. Coach Ron's one of our newer members. He was in the membership class, like I think the end of 2022, I believe. He joined up with us, and I got to tell you about this guy. I'm a Facebook friend of his. He's out on the trail walking every day. It's how he stays in such good shape. And he's talking to people, and he's pushing, not pushing, he's selling, he's entertaining them with his book that he's written. But another thing that Coach Ron does is he invites people to come here. He invites people every week to come here. He brags about us and says how wonderful we are, and he brings people into our door. He does his darn best. So let's all be like Coach and bring our friends and fill this place up. I've got another friend. We talked about maybe roping off behind the poles back there and not letting y'all sit there and say that that part is reserved for future members. So I haven't gotten approval from the powers that be to do that. But just an idea. So, how about those Olympics this last couple of weeks? Kind of get on with what I came here to talk about. So I'm not a sports person. Sorry, the two coaches I know that are sitting in the room. I'm not really a sportster. I swam in high school, and I didn't swim well. Coach always put me in to take up fifth or sixth slot because those didn't count. So that's my experience with sports. But every 4 years in the summertime, I become a big sports enthusiast, and I just love watching these young people gather together in this kind of historic thing, the Olympics. The Olympics that for 1,200 years went on in ancient Greece. For 1,200 years, every 4 years, these warring city-states would calm themselves down for a period of time enough to allow their athletes to travel to Olympia, the home of Zeus, Zeus's patron city, travel to Olympia to perform their best for their gods and their country. And it was all put to a stop by, guess what? A Christian emperor who didn't believe in pagan things. It was resurrected in the late 1800s. And with the same kind of purpose, right? To bring people together in peace, to bring people together to share their cultures, and to compete in sport. That sport just brings about a brotherhood, a sisterhood. It's been really fun these past 2 weeks. It feels to me, maybe because in 2020, they didn't get to have an audience, and they didn't get to have their families, and they didn't get to interact so much with each other. But this year, there's been just such displays of beautiful international sportsmanship. You know, I watched the winning divers the other day shower off and then start hugging each other because they were excited for each other. We all watched Chiles and Biles bow down to Andrade when she was on the gold for the podium. You know, there's just been some really great, wonderful moments like that of sportsmanship. And I think of the Olympics as really embodying this power of intention. And so that's why I decided to bring them into it a little bit, the power of intention. I'm just going to put my Olympic rings up behind me. So the power of intention, they've had to work hard. They have maybe the purpose of being the best shooter. You know, but that's a purpose. Hopefully they have a bigger purpose than that. But for our intents right now, they have that purpose. But each time they go to do their sport, they have to have the intent of hitting that target that day at that time. Um, I really just want my Olympic rings right now while I talk about the Olympics. So they have the power of intention working for them. Okay, I gotta stop and gather myself. And you know, I always wanted to be like Reverend Barbara, who was here last week. She also doesn't feel like a guest speaker. She feels like one of us. She always tells a joke, but I'm not really good at jokes either. But what would be the fastest dinosaur in the Olympics? Anybody know? The Prontosaurus. The Prontosaurus. I had to go to like a list of bad dad jokes to try and find a joke, and y'all didn't even laugh. The Prontosaurus. But the reason why I liked that joke was one of my favorite memes was this young lady who won a gold medal jumping on a trampoline, and she just happens to be a young lady named Brianna Page, and she studied dinosaurs in college, and she wrote a paper on the acoustic signaling of dinosaurs. So if you've got children or grandchildren who say they want to grow up and jump on trampolines, and to play with dinosaurs, do not discourage that. It's turned out to be a legitimate career path for this person. Okay, I stole that from the internet. But there's been a lot of overcoming. There's been a lot of overcoming to get to this Olympics, right? You've got well, Andrade, the one that won the gold on the floor exercise. She's torn her right ACL 3 times. It's amazing that she can do a triple or some kind of a flip and land on that knee. That's amazing to me. You've got Katie Ledecky, one of our gold medal swimmers, who's overcoming a thing called Potts syndrome, learning to work with that in her life. You've got the controversial Noah Lyles, who has overcome asthma and anxiety and depression and all kinds of things to become the winner by, like, what did they say, 5/1,000ths of a second in the 100-meter race. I'm not a runner, you guys. I used to run really slow, like I do everything. But to watch those guys just take off and boom, they're there, like 9-point-something seconds. It's amazing to me. And one thing that he said really sounded so unity to me. He said that what you have does not define what you can be. What you have does not define what you can be. And what he meant by that in unity speak is that the condition that you might see in your life as an obstacle does not define what you are and what you can be. It's a tenet that the prayer chaplains practice every time we pray with you. You bring us a problem, and we call it in our heads a condition, and we don't focus on that condition. We focus on what you really are and what you really can be, just like Louise did in her beautiful prayer this morning. We focus on those things that we are. And I love that I heard this out of the mouth of an Olympian. And then Simone Biles, she took a lot of flack in 2020 when she sat back. She knew that her mind and her body were not syncing together. They weren't doing what they needed to do for her to safely practice her sport. Those women make it look so easy, but it's a dangerous sport. And if they land wrong, they may never walk again. So she took a lot of flack for that, but she opened up this conversation for all these athletes to begin talking about mental health, to talk about and to go to the therapist's couch without shame or blame or any of that kind of stuff, and to really dig deeper into the way that our minds and our bodies work together. So these are some of the overcoming things that happened. And these guys set intentions to get there, right? They set a goal. And then they set little intentions along the way. Now, Barb talked last week about purpose. And purpose, we actually talked together, and we were, this is supposed to be a series of 3 weeks about intention. So you're going to hear more about intention next week as well. And Barb told me she was talking about purpose, and she said, so maybe you could talk about intention. And I was like, I'm not sure I know what the difference is between purpose and intention. So it gave me a chance to kind of dig a little deeper about that. And so I see purpose as kind of our overarching reason for being. And then I begin to see intention as helping us to reach that overarching purpose. And I went and looked up the word. I always do that when I'm going to give a talk. And intention comes from a Latin word, intentio. And intentio can have a variety of different subtle meanings. So a couple of them are strain and tension. And so you know how when we, like Anne said, there's life lessons. Life gives us lessons. We set an intention, and sure enough, life is going to give us something that's going to stretch us a little bit, right? It can also mean increasing and augmenting. And I love this word augment, because to augment something, you're not changing it in any way. It is what it is. You're just increasing it. You're making more of it. You're making it bigger. So I love that idea of intention, that we already are what we are, but when we set intentions, which we're going to talk about, we become maybe not more of that, but we become more consciously aware of that, which makes it seem that we are more of that. And it's got that idea of exertion or effort, which fits pretty well with talking about Olympics. You know, you got to put forth a little effort to have what you want to have in life. So as I watched them this past couple of weeks, I thought about what it takes for them to get to this peak, this Olympus that they're going to. They've got to work with fundamentals, right? Right, Fred? Right, Coach? They've got to work with fundamentals. Got to learn how to dribble that ball. Got to learn how to throw that ball. Got to learn how to do that somersault. Got to learn how to have the balance to stay on that beam. They've got all these fundamentals that they run over and over and over again. The musicians have stepped out, but we do it with music too. You know, I was a musician. I played piano. I hated doing scales. My teacher was never happy with my scales. They had to be so perfect. They were the fundamentals. That was what all the music was going to be built on, was my ability to play those scales. Once we've got the fundamentals, we can build on that. We can build a routine. Once we've got one flip, we can turn that into two flips or three flips. Once I've got a scale, I can branch out and play the notes in a different order and make a song out of it. And then once I know all the rules in music, I can start breaking them. I don't know that in sports you can really break the rules a lot. So, but you build on that. You begin to create something more out of your fundamentals. And they do a lot of work. I heard a lot of Olympians in interviews talking about visualization. Visualization. So some of them do it by writing in journals. Suni Lee talked about writing out her routines. I sit down when I'm going to speak, and I write out everything that I'm going to say. And then I don't really say it. But I start with that. I start with writing that out. So some people write out. There was one girl in the track and field events who sat down after every turn she took and jotted something down in her journal. You know, writing something down helped her to visualize it. Some of us are kinesthetic like that. You saw the Ukrainian lady meditating and maybe taking a nap on her sleeping bag. I thought she was so cute and adorable. Just pull that sleeping bag out, and I'm going to close my eyes now, and I'm going to visualize and maybe take a nap. And our Clark Kent guy of the pommel horse, Stephen, whose last name I will totally butcher when I try to say it, he was caught on the video meditating quite regularly as he waited for his event. So this visualization can become meditation as well. How many of you guys feel like you're great visualizers? I never felt like I was a great visualizer, but we're gonna do a little visualizing exercise right now. It's not really a spiritual meditation or anything like that. I just want to show you how you can bring so much more into your visualizing than just a picture in your mind. So will you play with me? All right. If you're comfortable, go ahead and close your eyes, because it is easier to visualize with the eyes closed. And I would like you to bring into your mind's eye the picture of a lemon, that wonderful yellow fruit, kind of round, maybe a little oval, that lemon. And I want you to kind of feel that with your mind's eye, feel that slightly rough, not quite perfectly smooth peel on that lemon. And maybe it's got that little knob on the top. You feel that lemon in your hand. Feel the weight of it. you might begin to be able to feel, to smell the scent of that lemon. Now imagine that you are taking your other hand and picking up a knife, and you slice through that lemon. You hear the sound of the knife going through the lemon. You hear it breaking open. That smell of lemon, that delicious, sweet, tart smell of lemon wafts up into your nostrils. Can you smell that lemon now? You see that lemon, you feel that lemon, you smell that lemon. Is your mouth watering yet? You can open your eyes. Are you ready to go get some lemonade at Coffee and Conversations? So when the idea being that when we visualize, the more senses that we bring into our visualization, the more real it becomes to us. I could just feel that lemon and taste that tart taste by the time I was done speaking to you. So visualizing is a great tool, and I know these athletes have worked on this a lot. And then they trust, right? Then they trust that they've got it. They've learned this. They've practiced this. They know what they're doing. Sydney with the two last names that I wrote down somewhere here. But you know the one that's out in front of the pack every time she runs a race. She said that you can't go out and worry about how someone else is going to run. You only can go out and worry about how you're going to run because you've practiced this. You know what you're going to do. It doesn't matter what anybody else out there is doing. You do it. You trust yourself. And that's a good lesson for us as well. Learning to trust that we've learned our fundamentals. And then once you get to the Olympics and you get to your event, you see them in these positions where they're centering themselves. I like the way the divers do it because they usually bring their arms up, take a deep breath, and bring their arms back down. And that I love centering like that. It gets the shoulders back and the breath in the belly, and you really can become centered in that space. And if you look at, we have these amazing close-up cameras, these giant lenses that can get right in these people's faces. You look right into their eyes and you just see the focus. They are focused on that goal. They are focused on that beam. They are focused on that ball. They're focused. They know where they're going. They know what the play is going to be. They know the routine. And their entire focus goes into that. And then it's ready, set, go. And they act. They spring into action. I love being a swimmer. I love that moment of flying off the blocks and into the water. And then they just go. They just go. They trust the muscle memory. They trust their brain. They trust that they know what they're doing. And they just go. They can visualize where they're supposed to be by a certain time. They can remember what the plays are going to be, but they've got to go with the flow of what's going on. They just go. And they have to let go. They have to let go, like I said. They can't worry about what someone in the next lane is doing. They can't worry about what someone else's routine looked like. They just have to let go and do their best. Sydney, who is a great source of wisdom, she said that because she runs out in front all the time, she doesn't feed off of anybody else's energy a lot of times. She feels separate from everybody else. One thing she said was she doesn't look back. She doesn't look back, and she doesn't fear what's coming up behind her, because if she fears what's coming up behind her, it'll catch her. So she's just out there like a racehorse running out in front. So what does any of this have to do with us as spiritual seekers? We're going to talk a little bit about sacred intention. We purchased these booklets. We've got a good number of them. They're going to be out on a table out front. And if you guys want to pick one up, they're really great. It's 30 days of living with intention. And our prior minister, Ellen Debenport, wrote the intro to it. And she talks in the intro about sacred intention. So this is where we move from the idea of the physical world that we live in and we are doing things, doing. And a lot of times when we talk about intention, that's what we think of. I'm going to set an intention to make $1,000, or probably you're setting one for more than that, but I'm going to set an intention to lose 10 pounds. But what we really want to think about and focus about as spiritual beings having a human experience is the metaphysical, not the doing as much as the being. We want to focus our intention on how we're going to be, and this little booklet is really helpful in that. When we set intention, it helps us direct where our attention is going. And our attention, what the things that we put our attention on, helps us to act according with the intentions that we have set. To be sacred means to be set apart for a special purpose. Last week, Peggy Miller and I got into a discussion about cutting some fabric, and we have sacred scissors, don't we, Peggy? Did all of y'all's moms have those? The women know what I'm talking about. Sacred scissors. They are set apart for only the purpose of cutting cloth. And if you dare take my sacred scissors and cut a piece of paper, you know what is in trouble. So it's set apart for a certain purpose. A lot of people think of it as a religious thing, and it's religious vestments or religious rituals and that kind of thing. We don't have a lot of that in Unity. I think maybe our little chaplain stoles set us apart. On those Sundays that you see someone wearing a stole, feel free to approach them for the sacred intention of prayer. Our chapel is set apart for prayer and meditation. We don't have meetings in there. We try to keep contention and that sort of thing out of that chapel and just set it apart for the sacred purpose of prayer. So it's to be set apart. And in our lives, our grand purpose is to realize, to be, and to express our divine potential, which is the Christ nature. I stole that from Paul Hasselbeck. And our intentions can help us to reach that. Another definition of sacred I love is that it's something that's inviolable, which is a word that means it can't be violated, it can't be dishonored. So our sacred being, our being one with the one power and the one presence, is inviolable. It can't be violated. It can't be dishonored. The only way I can think that it can be dishonored is if we don't own it. If we don't own it, we dishonor it. We are one with the one, and our most sacred words are I am. The I am that I am. That was the answer that the God of Moses gave when he said, who are you? I am that I am. I don't think you can tell. This picture is supposed to represent as above, so below. And that's us. Not that we think that God is out there above, but we reflect those divine ideals, which I tend to reach up whenever I say that, because I think of something higher. I think of something something lifted up, something bigger than me. And yet, I am it. I am it. We are a wave in that ocean of beingness, and we are everything that that wave is. We are the salt. We are the wetness. We are the microorganisms. We're everything that that wave is, everything that God is. We are. So how does this fit in with talking about the Olympics? I think that we train just like Olympians do, right? We learn our fundamentals. Our fundamentals, our opening statement is a fundamental. There's a one power and one presence active in my life and in the universe. That's a fundamental that we build on every day with everything we do. When we go into prayer, we go into prayer with an attitude that we are one with that one power, that we have already what we ask for. It's already in us. We already have it. When we ask for prosperity, we already are the quality of abundance. when we're looking for love and we're praying for a special person in our life, we are love. We are love. We are never lacking in love. And that's a problem we have a lot of times. We're trying to look for it outside of ourselves. And I'm going to put a plug here right now that I hadn't planned on putting in for the Quantum Living Program. I think a lot of you are getting the wrong impression about the Quantum Living Program. You've got the impression that it's all about doing shadow work. Oh my God, we're so tired of doing our shadow work. And there's an element of that. There is an element of digging deep to find out why we get triggered about certain things. Because I'm going to say, if you're honest with yourself, you probably get triggered. I figured out that I know how to know when I'm triggered. I usually want to cuss. That means something triggered me. But what the program is really about, and if you're really doing it as you should be and you're doing it to completion, you move past that thing. You moved past that thing that you lacked in your life that is now causing you to be triggered, and you figure out what it is that could fill that space and how you can fill it for yourself so that you're not out there always looking for love in the wrong places. Because you're so full of the love that you are that you take yourself on a date. You buy yourself some flowers. You do the things that make you feel nurtured and loved and cared about. And that's what that Quantum Living Program is really about. So I just wanted to correct that misperception that's going around. It's really about learning how to find everything in yourself that you already are so that you can live from that. So that's my plug for that program. So we learn our fundamentals. We build on it with programs like Quantum Living or by taking classes or by spending more time in prayer. Maybe you first start out just meditating a couple of minutes and eventually you add more minutes until you're sitting maybe not as long as Charles did in the silence, but a good amount of time in the silence. Visualizing. So you can take that lemon visualization and you can start turning that into something else in your life that you're looking for. Bringing in all of your senses and learning how to visualize what it is you want to see in your life. And trust. Trust that it's there. It's already there. It's already there, you guys. We are it. We are it. And when life gives us lessons, because that's our Olympics, right? When life decides, oh, here's your lesson. Now what are you going to do? That's our Olympics. That's our personal Olympics. When a challenge comes up, we learn to center. We learn to go into that silence. And for those who might be newer to Unity, our founder, Charles Fillmore, says of the silence, it is a state of consciousness entered into for the purpose of putting each person in touch with divine mind, so that the soul may listen to the still, small voice. So practice that fundamental. And when you do, it'll be there right for you. When life brings you a lesson, you'll know how to go there, even if it's just for an instance. Charles is known to have meditated a lot, but he also said, you can trust yourself. When you've got these skills, you can trust yourself. If you've got a challenge, to just go there for an instant, and you'll find your answers. And the things that we want to focus on when we're getting to that focus part, when we're in that stillness, we want to focus on those aspects of the divine that are going to help us with this particular issue. We have a famous teacher in Unity named Paul Hasselbeck, and one of his students gave him this, but I don't know the student's name, so I credit Paul. What happens in vagueness stays in vagueness. So we know that we are all that God is, but that's really vague. That's really a lot. So when life brings us lessons, maybe sometimes we choose certain aspects. Maybe we choose love. Maybe we choose wisdom. Maybe we choose to focus on the energy of life coursing through every cell, creating health in our being. So we choose those things and we make those our intention. We make those aspects of the godness our intention, and we bring a feeling to match that intention. And that's a big part of that Quantum Living program too, to start to recognize feelings that match the things we're trying to create in our life. Because we really create and manifest not just from thoughts, but thoughts attached with feeling. That's why Myrtle Fillmore was such a big proponent of singing, because there's typically some feeling that comes with singing a song that just activates that thought and takes it higher. And then we're going to act. We're going to, oh no, this is, I threw this one in there. This is Kansas City. The Cafe Gratitude. Didn't someone talk about us having a menu in life recently? If you can't think of a feeling to go with the thing that you're trying to work on, just bring gratitude. That's a great feeling. And it opens up your heart. It opens up your heart. Go to the Cafe Gratitude and bring that feeling along with you. And then we trust we've got it and we act. I love this pic. This is also from Unity Village. It's a rose. Just trusting that it's a rose. It's meant to be there. It looks like it's all by itself, but there's actually a huge garden of roses behind it. And it's just being a rose. It knows what it is, and it's being one of the most beautiful roses I've ever seen. And we're like that rose. We just have to trust that we have that in us. And I can't read that slide from here. Oh, this is just a quote of Charles Fillmore saying that if you can see it, you can do it. That's basically what all those words say. I'm running a little short on time, so I'm going to let you guys go. I want to talk about the contagious energy. So one thing that people that were at the Olympics, athletes that were there this year, that were also at the 2020 Olympics that actually happened in 2021 because of COVID, one of the things they really noticed this time was the energy, the contagious energy of the crowds. They didn't have that in Tokyo. They didn't have anybody sitting there cheering them on. At these games, they had 70,000 people in some of those stadiums cheering them on. And the day that all the girls fell off the balance beam, nobody was making any noise. It kind of freaked them out because they're used to having some noise going on. They're used to that contagious energy that they have. So we are that for each other. We are the contagious energy. We've got an energy field. My energy field is interacting with your energy field. And we can build together when we set our intentions in unison and create. And we're in a critical time for our community. We are putting together our call team to find our new minister. So this is a critical time for us to really have a contagious energy and to claim and to be all the things that we are and that we want to see in that person that's coming to stand up here regularly and to be a minister to us. So I encourage you to pick up these little booklets and we'll all join together. We're a little behind, but we'll do 30 days of intention. And a lot of the intentions that are written in this booklet, they're about being. They're not about doing. It's about being the love, being the joy, being in gratitude. And I think I'm finished with that. We might want to take just a couple of minutes to close our eyes and just enter into that state of knowing that there is only one presence and one power, and we are it. We connect with that. We breathe into that. We acknowledge that and we own that, because not to do so is to dishonor all that God created us to be. And so we are the love, we are the peace, we are the joy. And we go out in that together as we get to listen to another beautiful song about beauty, rebuilding a beautiful city. And when you think of, when you hear this talking about the city of man, know that it's the city of God, because we are that. Amen.
Are you sure you don't want to be the minister? Just thought I'd ask. Thank you, Lisa. That was a lovely, lovely, lovely. So this is the time in our service when we want to thank you for being here today, and thank you for your offering, blessing our church. And please invite friends. Please reach deep into your hearts and help support everything that this church supports and is so involved in within our city. We actually, our church actually donates to Unity Village so that Unity Village stays afloat. So lots of wonderful things ahead, including, take it away, Rhett. I get so excited about the music. So let's do the offertory blessing, and I will add to that, say it like you mean. Right? All right. Together. Divine love, as me, blesses and multiplies all that I am, all that I give, and all that I receive. Thank you, Spirit.
Out of the ruins and rubble, out of the smoke, out of our night of struggle, can we see a ray of hope? One pale thin ray reaching for the day, we can build a beautiful city. Yes, we can. Yes, we can. We can build a beautiful city, not a city of angels, but we can build a city of men. We may not reach the ending, but we can start slowly but truly mending, brick by brick, heart by heart. Now, maybe now, we start learning how we can build a beautiful city. Yes, we can. Yes, we can. We can build a beautiful city, not a city of angels, but we can build a city of men. When your trust is all but shattered, when your faith is all but killed, you can give up bitter and battered, or you can slowly start to build a beautiful city. Yes, we can. Yes, we can. We can build a beautiful city, not a city of angels, but finally a city of men. A city of men. A city of men.
Wow, that was wonderful. And just so, so honest. Thank you, Rhett. Thank you, Rhett. Let's stand and join together in song.
Let there be peace on earth, and let it begin with me. Let
us walk with each other in perfect harmony. Let peace begin with me. Let this be the moment now. With every step I take, let this be my joyous vow. To take each moment and live each moment with peace eternally. Let there be peace on earth, and let it begin with me.
And as we just take a moment, take a breath as we go about this new week. Listen to the still small voice. Get quiet and know you can visualize it and you can have what you need. And let the people say together, amen.